Linda presents this unabridged recording of Dreaming of Zhou Gong, written by Traci Harding and read by Jing-Xuan Chan. The dedication reads, "For Harold Hopkins, who died on the 11th of December, 2011. You were a dear friend, a great actor, and a wonderful human being. You are sorely missed. I must be slipping. It has been so long since I dreamt of the Duke of Zhou." Confucius.
Heaven's Mandate. In the past, the Shang King, Zhongzong, solemnly attended to Heaven's mandate with the utmost care, fashioning ordinances to rule the people, always fearfully alert lest he should dare to become self-indulgent. For this reason, Zhongzong enjoyed his throne for 75 years. When the throne passed to Gaozong, who had toiled long away from the capital, joining together with the common people, he observed the three-year mourning period in perfect silence, living in a hut by his father's grave. And when he did at last speak, his words were joyful, yet he did not dare become self-indulgent. He brought peace to the state of Shang, and none, whether great or small, had any complaint. For this reason, Gaozong enjoyed his throne for 55 years. When it came to Zhujia, he was at first unrighteous as king, and was forced to dwell for long away from his throne, and so came to know the lot of the common people. He learned to succor the common people, and was never to disgrace those who were alone, without husbands or wives. For this reason, Zhujia enjoyed his throne for 33 years. Otherwise, from the reign of the Shang founder, Tang, to that of Di Yi, none performed the proper sacrifices to make their virtue bright. None were a suitable match for heaven. Now Di Yi's son, Zishou, is greatly dissolute and lax. He attends neither to heaven nor to the needs of the people. His people are all under a sentence of death. In the meantime, King Wen of Zhou did not take the time even to eat a meal while the sun was in the sky, and so he enjoyed the throne of the Zhou people for 50 years. Zhou Gongdan, Duke of Zhou. The Book of Documents. At one time, the Shang government had tenfold the population and wealth of the Zhou territories. But by the advent of the death of our great father, Shibo Chang, leader of the West and of the Zhou peoples, the land was divided into three parts, two of which were Zhou. At the end of the three-year mourning period for Shibo Chang, my eldest brother, Ji Fa, rallied Zhou's troops with the intention of finishing what our great father started, the total defeat of the Shang. But the signs were not good for success. There were landslides at the mountain of Yao, and Ji Fa, Zhou's new Shibo, was urged by his advisers to be patient and await more favourable conditions to strike. 3 years have passed, and Ji Fa is still uncertain whether the time to strike the Shang Empire is nigh. Our Prime Minister, Zhang Taigong, is in agreement with him, and whilst in private conference in the Shibo's council chambers at our ancestral home at Haojing, he advocated this path to Ji Fa and myself. "While I was fishing on the fateful day when I first met your great father, I realized one truth. If you want to succeed, you need to be patient. We must wait for the appropriate opportunity to eliminate the emperor, Zishou, and his Wu concubine and general, Su Daji." "I agree," Ji Fa stated, although his tone implied he was only half in accord. "However, those who flocked to support me and mourned in patience for 3 years and refrained from action for another three will not be content to delay further without good reason. I had to sympathize with my eldest living brother's reluctance to delay, as there was much bad blood between the Ji family and the Shang ruler, Zishou. Yet in this instance, I felt we could not allow our personal feelings to influence such an important political decision. We had to trust that by the grace of Jen, ruler of heaven, a chance to avenge the deaths of our great father and beloved eldest brother would come in time. I believe I may have a solution, I spoke up, for there was an observation I had made some time ago that weighed heavily on my mind. Jifa looked my way. Your counsel is always welcome, Dan. Heaven knows you are the smartest of us all. In saying us all, the Shibo referred to our 9 brothers, 8 since the death of our eldest brother, Bo Yi Kao. I found my brother's flattering view abstruse, as it was Kao's goodness and intellect that I had always aspired to emulate, for in reality he was the most sagacious and beloved son of Shibo Chang. I believe, dear brother, that your hesitation to attack stems from the fact that the heavenly order to conquer the Shang has not been given. The troubled expression on the Shibo's face transformed into one of complete clarity. The mandate of Tian. Tian was the name the Zhou people used to refer to the ruler of heaven, who was neither male nor female. Exactly. The order to attack can only be given by heaven, I concurred. The people will understand and respect this. Are you suggesting that we consult the Wu? The Prime Minister was concerned, as the Wu were an ancient holy order of female shamans, who were in the service of heaven, and they were known to have extraordinary powers. The Emperor's wife, Da Ji, is Wu. The people fear her supernatural power and despise her inhumanity. I served our dear advisor a look that implied that he was preaching to the converted. Da Ji murdered our eldest brother because she was sick with lust for him. No one hates that shape-shifting witch more than I. But the fact remains, mere warriors are never going to be enough to destroy her. We need a Wu to kill a Wu. Jifa nodded as he began to see the wisdom behind my reasoning. No man can give you permission to destroy the Shang. I pointed out another benefit. Only the Wu in the service of the supreme god, Tian, can communicate the will of heaven to the people. And only the great mother of the Wu can bestow upon a family Tian's heavenly mandate. Yi Wu Li Shan. Jifa uttered the great mother's name with reverence. My great-grandfather told me tales when I was a young boy about the oracle woman and her house of Wu on Li Shan. Could she possibly still be living? She is said to be immortal, Highness. Zhang Taigong stated his understanding of the matter. There has never been a report of her death, only of her miracles. A prophecy of the downfall of Shang is said to have sprung from the Wu of Li Shan. I added further weight to my argument. And the prophecy states that Zishou will go up in flames, and along with him the Shang dynasty will end. So who, in heaven's eyes, should take his place, I wonder? My brother was inspired. You think the Great Mother may have foreseen that also? It is entirely possible, I answered. And of course, the legendary Shan Yu Jiang Hudan is said to reside at Li Shan, along with her tigress sister, Shan Yu Jiang Huxin. The mere mention of their names put the look of horror back on my brother's face. For all Wu had supernatural power, but none, by the evil Su Da Ji, was so famed as these women. Why would they help us? Our family has neglected to pay homage to the Great Mother ever since the Emperor was bewitched by his wife, Su Da Ji, and turned into a compassionless tyrant. I agreed that the notion of seeking the aid of the Wu was daunting. There were many unknowns and variables to my strategy. Yet my gut instinct told me this was the way forward. In reality, we had no other feasible option, as far as I could surmise. We nobles fear being bewitched in such a manner by the Wu, I stated. But love for the women of the heavenly orders has not been lost among the common people, who still readily seek their advice, healing, and spiritual counsel. I have been looking into the history of the Wu, as they have always advised and anointed the emperors in the past. However, never, before Su Daji, has a Wu left the service of heaven to pursue an earthly life of such debauchery and self-pleasure. So you're saying that Daji would be considered a disgrace to her heavenly sisters? Zhang Taigong was most interested to learn this fact. Actually, the Wu refer to each other as brothers, to reinforce that they are equal in status to men. Their great mother they call Shifu, for the same reason, for no man on earth has dominion over her, or any of the students of her house, not even the emperor. The Wu answer only to Tian. That could be dangerous. The Prime Minister voiced the concern that was clear in his expression. The Wu are not interested in earthly affairs or pleasures, only in heavenly service. But the fact that one of the Wu is preventing us from achieving peace could certainly help us to gain their favour, I concluded happily, for I was deeply curious about the Wu. They were said to have abundant knowledge about the inner and outer workings of heaven and earth, and, as a scholar, I could not help but wonder what they could teach me. The Zhou must return to honouring Tian and his mistresses if the Ji family is to win heaven's mandate. Ji Fa smiled. This path sits well with me. He looked to his prime minister for his approval. There is certainly no harm in making initial contact with the Wu and testing the waters for an alliance between heaven and earth, Zhang Taigong granted. That would certainly appease the people, who miss the great festivals once presided over by the Wu, before Su Daji forbade all Wu within Shang states to practice. Fortunately, the temple of the Great Mother on Li Shan was deep in Zhou territory, almost inaccessible, and so the house of the Great Mother had been left in virtual peace to thrive. The Shibo nodded, most pleased. We shall keep this quiet for the moment. He looked at me. Done. I charge you to go to Li Shan and seek the blessing of the Great Mother on my behalf. Of course, the notion pleased me greatly. It was a rare opportunity to satisfy some of my curiosity regarding the Wu. Yet I shook my head, not to disobey, but in warning. I am fairly certain that gaining heaven's mandate will be no simple matter, brother. There will be tribute to pay for our neglect of the holy house of Tian, trials to accomplish and sacred rites to observe in order to appease heaven and then find out exactly what is required, the Shibo interjected. For even if I was to depose Zishu, he has a son to whom heaven's mandate may be passed. Do I kill the son, Wu Geng, for fear of the same madness erupting if he lives to rule? Some divine insight is exactly what I require. If I am granted heaven's mandate, only then can I be sure that the demise of the Shang state is the will of Tian and in best interests of the people. This conclusion was personally satisfying, for I too needed some divine reassurance that the blood feud we were about to embark upon was indeed divinely meant. Hence I rose and bowed to my eldest brother and the Prime Minister to take my leave of them. I shall depart for Li Shan at once. Never had I been assigned a quest that so inspired me, and with this sense of purpose, I hastened my exit from the Shibo's council chambers. My interest in the mysterious ways of the Wu had been ever growing since the untimely deaths of my father and my eldest brother at the hands of Su Daji. There had to be a way to combat her supernatural advantage. The laws of divine polarity dictated that it be so. As I proceeded down the stairs and into the grandly cobbled central courtyard at Haojing, I was determined to discover that counterforce, and prevent Su Daji from unleashing her evil power ever again on any member of my family or the good people of Zhou.
Part 1. The Wu. Chapter 1. Yi Wu Li Shan. The sky above was dark and flashed electric with the promise of a storm that might break the long drought. Thunder growled in the distance. Through the steam clouds rising off the thermal waters, the torches of summons burned brightly in the night on the jetty ahead. This was the only means to request an audience with the Wu of Li Shan, and she had been sent in response to the summons. A team of hooded ferry women at her back were moving the ferry boat across the surface of the shallow thermal lake, using the power of their qi. No oars or ropes were required. This vessel was the only official means for supplicants to gain access to the temple of the Great Mother, for everyone knew that any man who attempted to reach the House of the Holy Orders uninvited never returned. The occupants of the ferry had their faces shrouded by the hoods of their long, dark robes. But, as the representative of the Great Mother, she herself was dressed in white and stood on the bow of the ferry to address the seeker of their counsel. As their vessel neared the jetty, the noise in the rumbling sky was matched by the din before them. The rattle of battle armor, warrior chatter, and horses served to tell her that a small army lay in wait. She motioned for the ferry to halt on the water at a good distance from the pier. "Speak," she requested, and the commotion quickly hushed to silence. "The Wu of Li Shan are listening." "I am Jidan, come to seek the guidance of the Great Mother on behalf of my brother, Jifa, leader of the West." Both names were legendary. The sons of Shi Bozhang were increasingly idolized by the common people of Zhou. The mightiest warlords in the land had come to the temple, just as the Great Mother had predicted. "We were deeply saddened to hear of the death of Jizhang, your great father," she said in condolence. "He brought a lasting peace and calm to the West." During the course of his life, Jizhang had been recognized as a well-educated, conscientious, and benevolent leader, dedicated to educating the population, promoting good ethics, assisting agricultural development.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.